Hello everyone, and welcome back to the epic match between Bobby Fischer and Boris Spassky from 1992, the revenge match of the 20th century. And this time, as you can see, Bobby Fischer has the black pieces and Boris Spassky has the white pieces. And look at the picture of Bobby Fischer. It looks like Bobby Fischer is saying, "Don't mess with me." This was the era when Bobby Fischer was a badass. So let's check out how this game went on. I believe this game was also a pretty instructive chess game, but I will only show you the key moment in this chess game. So in this position, after rook to g1 by Spassky, Bobby Fischer is simplifying the chess game. After king takes on d1, defending the bishop, knight takes on f6, king takes on f6, and rook to f1, lining the rook with the king, the pawn is split, e takes on f5, but then rook takes on f5 by Spassky. Fischer is a pawn up. King to g7. And now, capturing the pawn, rook takes on e5. Bishop to d6 by Bobby Fischer. Attacking the rook. After defending the rook, Fischer simply captured the pawn. And once again, Bobby Fischer has the one pawn advantage. One extra pawn for Bobby Fischer. Is this endgame winning for black? We will see. After king to e2. We have h5, pushing the passed pawn. Fischer has the passed pawn. Rook to e7, checking the king. King to f6, rook to d7, and bishop to e5. b3, h4 by Bobby Fischer, king to f3, rook to g8, threatening rook to g3 and capturing the bishop. So bishop to g4. What would you do in this position? Well, Bobby Fischer played a good move. He pushed the pawn. We have rook to h7. Going back the pawn, the rooks are better behind the pawns. But let's take it back. If capturing the pawn with the bishop, if bishop takes on h3, what happens then? Then rook to g3, checking the king, and winning the bishop and the chess game. So let's take it back. After h3, in this position, we have rook to h7, h2 by Bobby Fischer. The bishop is defending the pawn. It looks like black is better, but this could be a draw, easily. Bishop to f4 by Spassky. What would you do in this position? Once again, Bobby Fischer played a very artistic move, a very good move. Well, Fischer played rook to f8, threatening to move the king and pinning the bishop and winning the piece. So what else? In this position, Boris Spassky captured the pawn, bishop takes on e5, but now king to g6 by Bobby Fischer with check. It is cool, isn't it? This is check, plus attacking the rook. After defending the king, black is going to win the exchange. Even this is instructive, but let's take it back. After check, if king takes bishop, then king to g3, and losing the advantage, black is going to get back the pawn. So let's take it back. After bishop takes on e5, we have king to g6 by Fischer. This is check. And after moving the king, king takes on h7, bishop takes on h2. Well, capturing the knight is not possible because of promoting the queen. That would be a funny blunder for white. So Spassky captured the pawn, bishop takes on h2, and rook to e8, checking the king. Well, in this position, Bobby Fischer has the exchange. Is it good enough for winning the game? King to f5. We have an interesting endgame. Developing the knight. And moving the king, attacking the knight with the bishop, knight to d4, bishop to d6, rook to e4, bishop to d7, rook to e2, a4, going back the pawn, bishop to b8, defending, bishop to e7, capturing the pawn, king to e5, knight to f3, checking the king, king to d6, knight to d2, and bishop to e6, rook to b4, defending and attacking by Bobby Fischer, king to c6, knight to b3, bishop to d5, and simply Bobby Fischer captured the pawn, but also Spassky captured the pawn. Bishop takes on b6, rook to a7, bishop takes on c5. Two bishops, the bishop pair, is always great. So Boris Spassky is defending with his two bishops. a4, bishop to b4, a3, c5. And we have knight to d4, checking the king. After moving the king, rook to d1. Lining the rook with the king and leaving the pawn. Of course, how would you promote the queen? when the bishops is defending like arrows. But in this position, Spassky simply captured the pawn, bishop takes on a3. What would you do? Well, Fischer played a dangerous looking move, knight to c2. Both attacking the dark square bishop and the light square bishop. The light square bishop is pinned. So c6 by Spassky, and then rook takes on d5 by Fischer. Capturing the bishop is a possibility, but then pushing the pawn, how to defend? Rook takes on d5, but king to c6. What now? Threatening to promote the queen. So this is also a draw. After rook to d1, promoting the queen, but checking the king. And this is a draw. Of course, you can checkmate the king with one knight. So let's take it back. After knight to c2, we have c6. And Bobby Fischer captured the bishop. Rook takes on d5. Spassky played the move and the draw was agreed. Bishop to d6. And there is no way for promoting the queen. So the possible continuation is very simple. White is threatening to push the pawn and promoting the queen. But rook to a5, c7, rook to a7, king to d8. And then rook takes on c7, bishop takes on c7. And this is a draw. An instructive chess game between Fischer and Spassky from 1992. So after bishop to d6, they agreed to a draw. They shook hands. I also would like to give you another interesting information about this match. Kasparov was the world chess champion at the time, and Garry Kasparov said that Bobby is playing okay. This is quote for Kasparov. Bobby is playing okay, nothing more. His strength is 2600 or 2650. It wouldn't be close between us. That's what Kasparov said. So in that era, Kasparov was almost 2800 rated player. On the other hand, Bobby Fischer's opponent, Boris Spassky, at the time, when he was for about 53 years old, if I'm not mistaken, his rating was 2545 at the time, and he was the 96th best player in the world in FIDE's rating list, and Bobby Fischer was inactive, so he had no rating at the time. But according to Yasir Seravan, his performance rating was for about 2645, which is very impressive for the time. That would make Bobby Fischer number 12 player in the world on the July 1992 list. So Garry Kasparov was for about 2800 rated player. But what would happen? The real question is that what would happen if Bobby Fischer would not stop playing chess? If he would be active, I think his rating would be much more higher. His performance rating would be higher. And I think he would be a serious contender for the World Chess Championship title, even at the age of 50. This match proved that Bobby Fischer was an incredible, unbelievable chess player. He was incredible. His strength was just freakish. Thank you for watching, and I hope to see you next time. Take care, and bye-bye.